Well, what up, what up, what up? What's going on, folks? Good Sunday evening. It's the pastor. Let me start off with a little music here and then get some more folks tagged up here so we can get this party going, y'all. With a little Frankie Beverly and Maze tonight. Started off another live a while back with this thing on, and yeah, we gonna kick it. Love that tune. Let me get some folks tagged up. I hope you all have had a wonderful Sunday, and it's a beautiful fall day out today. I didn't spend a whole lot of time out finishing up this week, family and everything. Son and daughter-in-law, or daughter-in-love, I should say, and two grandsons, they came in town, and along with Jasmine and her husband, son-in-love, and Brooklyn. We just kicked it a little bit. Come on, Frankie. Can't understand why we treat each other in this way. Taking my time. Oh, so happy to have this evening. In spite of all the stressors and the strains I know we've all been through. We got to get it down in here, y'all. We are one. Yep. That's it. No matter what we do. Yeah. That's the way it is. Yeah, get some folks tagged up. Tell y'all what, no matter what's going on, you know, no matter how much the world seems to be crumbling around us, the hope lies in the fact that if we ever get to understanding truly that we are one, that we all we got, man, we can overcome all of this chaos and pandemonium. That's why we continue to rock with the mantra, you know. We all we got. Try to get some more folks tagged up right here, right quick. Well, Frankie Beverly and it. And Maze chilling in the back. Down in your heart. Why is that concept so hard for people to understand? Anybody tell me? Why? I don't get it. And one of the reasons why I dug that out tonight is because, you know, not only does this week give me the opportunity to celebrate my wife's birthday, which was just an amazing occasion, but also to celebrate our 37th wedding anniversary after being together some about 42 years or so, you know. We are one. We all we got. We got to learn, folks. This is what we're here for. We're not here to fuss and fight and feud and trying to set each other up, backbiting and stabbing. And come on, folks. It's not what we're here for. I'm just like Frankie. I can't understand why we treat each other in this way. Doesn't make sense to me. We could accomplish so much more if we just learn how to work together. But he said the key right then, we have our love. And unfortunately today in this world we live in today, man, we ain't got that love. We ain't got that love one for another. We ain't got that love that'll transcend race or economic background or zip code. We ain't got that love that makes sure that kids are educated, people get paid right, and folks don't get shot sitting on their front porch or sitting in their living room. We ain't got that kind of love. And until we get that kind of love, we can't be one. We are one. That's the way it is. All right, that's about enough of this tag, and I'm sure I probably went over my limit. It'll be all good. What up, what up, what up? It's the pastor. I know. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. As I said earlier, the wifey will be in a minute. We're just going to chop it up a little bit, you know. Really just wanted to show some love. Just to show some love, you know. What up, soldier? What's up, Jason? Yes, sir. We rocking it for sure. For sure. Maddie, what's happening? How you doing? All righty, all righty. One for you, too. Believe that. Brooke, what's going on? Miss B, what's happening? Come on, Frankie. Do that. Yes. That's for sure. Let me stop this over here. Yeah. It's that darn Frankie, boy. All over. What up, what up? What? Not only what up, what up, what up, what up? I mean, I'm going to lean this up here right quick while I give some folks some shout out. I got the wifey with me. Mm-hmm. Man, my ace coon boom. Ain't that what the old school folk used to say? Chris, what's going on up in Greenville? All right, all right. Reaching out. See, I got to get you that playlist. Okay, Michelle, what's happening? All right, Cherry, what's going on? Donna, what's happening? I'm telling you, we need to do something together on universal health care, you know? I know let me just back that up. I know when Joe Biden and Kamala Harris win, we definitely got folks that's going to push it forward, especially with Joe Cunningham and Congressman Clyburn and Melissa Watson up in the 7th, Hosea Cleveland and Kim Nelson and all of the others that are running in South Carolina. We got some troopers going to push for universal health care, but you know, Donna, we still got to have boots on the ground for sure. Kim, what's going on? All right, family in the house. Dan Gregory, all right. Dan Gregory for County Clerk, Charleston County Clerk, that's for sure. Taisha Aiken in the house. Come on, Ty. Yes, I'm looking forward to being in Smokes next Sunday. Y'all stay tuned. Maybe y'all can, some can make that field trip. Miki, what's going on? All righty. Heather, what's happening? All righty. We got a few people on. Justin, what's up, soldier? What's going on? I done already told you. You know yours coming. That's for sure. We all we got. But yeah, that's all I got. To my right. Sean, what's happening? How you doing? All righty. Nina? Yes, yes, yes. We gotta bring that positivity, Maddie. That's for sure. We got to. We got enough negativity around here that a little positivity will shine that light in the dark place. You know, it don't take much. You know, if you're out in the woods in the dark in the middle of the night and you light a match, you can see that match for miles. You know, that's all it's going to take for us to shine the light in the dark place that we're in right now. And we'll turn this thing around. Gina Duggins, what's up? What's up, Gina? All right, all right. Good to see you. Gina is a Charleston County School Board candidate. For the peninsula, my candidate, I'm supporting her fully, that's for sure. Yes, yeah, Brooke, I got the wife with me tonight for a little while. Okay, for a little while. And what's going on? Charleston Uplift in the house. Yes, Herbert Fielding, Charleston County Coroner race. That's right. We got some candidates in the house tonight. Excellent. I'm loving it. How you doing, brother? All righty. So, let me think. Am I going to set this thing down or what? Let me think. I think I will. Y'all bear with me. Of course, I'm fumbling and mumbling and carrying on around in here. I think that'll be a little bit easier on my hands and on my these old muscles and carrying on, because I ain't got no muscles. That's for sure. But I'm going to give a couple more people a chance to get on right quick while I sit here with my best half. You know, actually, she's like 3/4. Of this equation, you know, I'm like 1/4 of this equation. Yeah, she. But I actually interrupted a study schedule that she has going on, so she's not going to be able to stay long. But the both of us wanted to just come on. I know it's been a while since we both just teamed up on a Facebook Live, and just to say hey to everybody. And, you know, like I was saying, it's just been an incredible week with her 27th birthday.
Oh, you can tell them. I don't mind. You don't live to be 60 every day. So.
All right. Come on now. Come on, somebody. For sure. Yeah. Okay. 60th birthday. I got permission. If all y'all young brothers on there, y'all understand now. There's certain things that you do, certain things that you don't. A happy wife is a happy life. That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Treat them good now. Treat them good. That's for sure. Because they can make your life a living heck.
Well, the man can make yours a living heck.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, it's that give and take of love, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's work, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Mm. Lots of it.
Mm. So we had our 60th birthday. We also had our 37th year of marriage, actually having said I do. And I think we courted for about, how many years? About 7 or 8 years before that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, about 7 or 8 years before we actually got married. So we've been together something like 47 years, 46 years, something like that. How old are you? It couldn't be no 46 years if you're 60. I ain't starting with no 14-year-olds now. Mm-mm. Mm. Mm-mm. But you sure enough with like 17, though. That's for sure. And fine. Fine. And still fine. Mm-mm. For sure. Mm-mm. Yeah. 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 You know, and I wanted to make sure that tonight, y'all know I could spend hours talking about the doom and gloom going around us, but it's sometimes you just got to break away from that and talk about some good stuff, you know. And having celebrated 37 years of marriage with this beautiful young lady to my right, I don't know what I did to deserve that, you know, because it wasn't easy. I know it couldn't have been easy for her. That's for sure. You know, and of course, you know, in any relationship, it's not easy on any side. But somehow or other, you know, by God's grace, you know, we made it. We made it. And thus far. And it's His grace, according to that song, His grace that's going to take us home. Because every day it's about give and take. It's about accepting one another for you know, with all the faults, defects, and shortcomings, in the good times and the bad times. I mean, this lady put up with me during my years of addiction and prison and all that, you know. And I don't understand it, but, you know, I hope that she's all right with it now.
Absolutely, absolutely. I just wanted to say thank you to all of you guys out there. Appreciate all the birthday wishes and anniversary wishes. We've had a great week. And matter of fact, I got a couple of more days off work. I'm studying for an exam that I'm taking right now. I am trying to become an ECMO specialist, and it's a lot of work. But anyway, the exam is tomorrow at 10. So, of course, you know, I have to come in. Do what I was asked to do. Come and say hello and goodbye. But anyway.
She said an ECMO specialist. Everybody out there sitting there saying, huh?
What is that? Oh, an ECMO specialist. It's a specialist. It's a life-saving specialist, actually. It's where you put people on life support, where you take all the blood out of the body, put it back into the body. Anyway, it's a long thing. And I don't want to get into all of that tonight, because wow, that's what this is not about tonight. But it's just about me advancing myself and my work, that's all. And like I say, I thank you guys for being so helpful. All you people that send in the birthday videos, it was so awesome. I was really taken back by that, Damon. Awesome job you did on your, what was it, the harmonica?
It's the melodica. Is
okay,
what it's called.
Well, that thing right there. Yeah, mm-hmm. It was so sweet. And thank you so much, guys. I appreciate you all.
Yeah.
And I am so truly proud of Thomas as well. So people always say, thank me for sharing him. I'm glad you all didn't know him back when he wasn't normal.
Shoot, me too. I'm glad.
I don't know if that's a person you would want to meet. But anyway, I appreciate the person that he is now. Ooh-wee. I am so grateful for that. And in all these years, it has not been easy. So I don't ever think marriage is easy because it's not. Mm-mm. It's always a give and take to it. And so I would recommend anybody that may be going through a struggle, always evaluate yourself first, because you don't know what it is about your own self that, you know, a lot of times we like, I call it that personality where you always think you can fix people, but sometimes you just have to fix yourself. Ooh. And that's what I did. I fixed me first before I was able to move on to accept him coming back into my life. So, and you know, you can't fix you without the power of God. I don't know what people believe in, but I just tell you what I believe. And I believe in the power of God and his strength and that spirit that dwells within me to take me to the levels that I am today and to be able to handle the things that I do handle. And it's because of that strength that I can do all things. They say do all things, he'll give you that strength. So, and that's that. I don't dwell on it. I don't hold no hard feelings about it. Initially, yes, but not now. The whole family has done a lot of growing. We've all matured, my children as well. And I just thank God we are where we now. We have grandchildren and we're continuously loving and caring. And we do the best that we can with what we got. So, and I thank God for that. So that's all I have to say tonight. If you have any questions you need to ask or need to be encouraged about, you always got my phone number. You know how to get me on Facebook if you need to do that. But I am always available to talk to anyone that needs to be encouraged and uplifted. And to, what's her name, Miki? I see you all the time, girl. So you hang in there.
Shout out to
Miki. I'm constantly praying for you. So just know you have prayer warriors on your side and each and every one of you that may be going through a struggle. I read the Facebook posts sometime. I don't always comment, but I do read them. So for all of you out there, hey, know that you got a praying sister here. So stay strong. I love you guys. And thank you so very much. And I hope y'all have a great rest of your night. Love you.
Wow.
Bye, dear.
All right, sweetie. I don't know how to follow that up. She's just an amazing and incredible. And, you know, it is just amazing to hear her say, because as many times that I've told my friends and those I associate with, especially women who might have some things they might want to talk about, because it's not always appropriate for a woman or she's comfortable with talking to a man about their issues. So there are many of you know, I've always said my wife is fully available and I've given her cell number so you can call her or whatever. She just told you. So I'm not making that up. Okay. She just told you if you got some things going on and you'd prefer to talk to another woman, she's right here. Okay. And You know, it's those kind of blessings that keep me moving forward, you know. She said that when I returned, it was when I returned from prison, you know. And while she was working on herself during those times, she didn't really know what was going to come back into her life after prison until I got home. And it wasn't long after getting home, and I've said this before, that she had to ask, where'd my husband go? What did you do to him? You're not the same person that went into prison. And we kind of really had to get to know each other again after prison, because the person that went into the prison system 3 years earlier is not the same one that came out. And sometimes, you know, you just have to wait and see. Sometimes, but I'm so glad that she did wait, that she didn't listen to her jackleg pastor, because she had one pastor when I went into prison who she was attending church with, who she talked over. You know, they say talk things over with your pastor. She talked it over with him, and he said that she should leave me. he told her to leave me. That's what the pastor said. And in her wisdom, she sought advice from others because the scripture says, let everything be established at the mouth of two or three witnesses. So she took that one witness and went to two more. And the other two said, don't do that. Give it some time. Give it some time. And so when I came home and we got back together, ultimately it led to her saying along the way that she really had gotten that person, that man, that husband that she had wanted all along. But because of my addiction, she didn't have that. And now for the last 19 years since returning from prison in 2001, the man that she had wanted all of those years earlier, the man that she wanted at the altar 37 years ago, 19 years ago, she got that person. Yeah. And I'm so happy. And I'm so humbled by it. And I'm so humbled by all of you all. And I look on this line, I see my niece, Patricia, on tonight. And I see a classmate of mine from elementary school, a year ahead, Teddy Jackson on board, for sure. Shout out to Ida B. Wells, 37th place in the house, that's for sure. That's for sure. Erica, good to see you. Erica Coakley for Charleston County School Board, the Consolidated School Board. I need you all to move her forward. I'm going to talk about announcements before I close this out tonight. I'm not going to be long. I'm going to talk about, in the announcements, I'm going to talk about my upcoming week and my focus this coming week, which is going to definitely be about the Charleston County School Board and the school board races. But races, R-A-C-E-S. Even though I could talk about the Charleston County School Board races too, without a problem, not a problem. But, you know, folks, my wife said it already, but I would be remiss unless I said it myself, although we are one, and that Frankie Beverly, deep down in my heart, we are one. But you all are just truly amazing and incredible. And I never feel as if I deserve your love, your care, your concern, how you reach out, how you embrace my family, how you welcomed all of us into your life. And I am so, let it be known that I never take that for granted. And there's a lot of times when folks got things going on and I'm kind of overwhelmed and I can't get around to everybody and I beat myself up about it. You know, one of the biggest times I beat myself up about it is when I miss people's birthdays. You know, I got on Facebook, I have somewhere in any given time between 4,975 and 5,000 friends on there. And I try to acknowledge everybody's birthday, you know, because everybody is important. It's just something inside of me that just wants me to make sure that everybody knows that they're special. No matter what your upbringing was, no matter whether anybody sowed into your personal life, no matter if anybody in your household, parent or otherwise, or even spouse, told you that they care, I want you to know that I care. Every last one of you. I have people who I've been saying happy birthday to for 4 or 5 years, and those are the only posts that are on their Facebook pages. I've grown recently to know, okay, if every time I say happy birthday, I see my same post from 2019 and 2018 and 2017, maybe I just need to go ahead on and unfriend that person, make some room. But I still, you know, it bothers me when I have to give a belated birthday wish. But a lot of times, because of the sheer numbers, it's just hard. But this, wow, my birthday being on September 14th, and then the grandkids' birthday, then our daughter's birthday, then my wife's birthday and our anniversary. You all have just blessed our heart. Every last one of you has blessed my heart. That's for sure. Gareth, you say you hope I missed all your birthdays. Did I? I hope I didn't. I sure hope I didn't. That's for sure. Because you're important to me. And I'm looking forward to making that trip down to, is it Alabama, Georgia? I'm looking forward to that. We got work to do. But, you know, y'all know I'm Pastor Dixon, right? And no, I am the associate pastor now at a church that's based in Mount Pleasant, Life Community Church, with Pastor Mike Cook. He's the founder of the church. I met Pastor Mike in 2018 in the aftermath of a shooting in North Charleston. Him and his son were working over here in North Charleston rehabbing homes for veterans for free. And two kids from Greg Mathis High School with a gun thought they might have had some money, and they went to rob them. This was 10:30 in the morning on a Friday morning. Went in to rob them, and the kid with the gun just started shooting. The first shot killed Mike's son, Brian, and then the kid shot Mike five times. And Mike survived. And I knew that that nobody in North Charleston was going to reach out to the family. So when I found out about the vigil for the son, for Brian, I attended the vigil. I didn't know that family at all. I've told this story before. I didn't know that family at all. And I didn't know whether they were going to reject me after all. And I'm a black guy. And these black kids had killed, you know, had shot the father and killed the son. Pastor of the church. Son was the music minister. So I went to the vigil, and that was the best thing I could have done because I got to meet some amazing people. And that was the beginning of a longstanding relationship. Mike got out of the hospital several weeks later, phenomenally recovered. And when I was at the vigil, those at the vigil said it'd be good if I met him. And I said I would love to. So when he came home, they had a memorial service for Brian. And I attended that, but I didn't talk to Mike then and just left my number. And later on, we talked. We talked on the phone and we began talking. And I met the family. And Vanessa and I went and visited at church service because I knew that this had to be a difficult time. It had to be a difficult time for them. And I've been standing with people who have lost loved ones to this craziness we call gun violence for so long that I knew that if I could at least, you know, be of some kind of comfort, then I needed to be there. And Vanessa felt the same way. And so we started fellowshipping there. And over time, it went from fellowshipping to developing just a relationship because they're just great people. Through tragedy, God brought together triumph, brought triumph from the tragedy. And so we continue to fellowship with them. Now I'm considered an associate pastor at the church. I'm just me, you know, for sure. And I like it because, you know, Life Community Church is my kind of place. You know, it's come as you are. Even when it wasn't COVID, it's still come as you are. You'll see Mike in flip-flops and me in Willie D's, but we're going to bring that message. That's for sure. A message of hope. A message of a better day, a brighter day that you can believe in. But that was a side venture. And by the way, I will be bringing a message this coming Sunday for anybody who'd like to tune in to my Facebook page at 10:15. And also on the 8th of November, I believe it is, and the 18th or something like that. Okay, I'll have more information up about that. But You know, I got on this tangent or went down this road because I wanted to talk about faith a little bit, and faith when it comes to my family. And now I'm not preaching, okay? This ain't about, I'm not trying to, as they say, proselytize people. That's a big old word that just means make disciples.
Stop fidgeting.
My wife told me to sit still. I fidget. That's what I do. But all right. I learned obedience a long time ago. But let me just back up, okay, and just talk about this. Something that happened in my family, in my family life, dealing with this whole prison situation that I started out talking about. That kind of, y'all go ahead on laugh. It's all right. That's a wife's job, you know. I think God has a sense of humor. That's why he gave us two eyes, but you know, even with our two eyes, we can never tell, we can never see with ourselves how to correct ourselves completely. We can see just so much of ourselves that we need somebody else to actually look at us and say, you know, you need to correct this, or you need to correct that, or you need to wipe that booger on your nose. As I can never, without a mirror, know I got a booger on my nose, but my wife will get that booger off your nose. I said, well, wife, you ain't going to want, no. Okay, but back to where I was at. I experienced during my change from that old self to this new self, I experienced a series of miracles in my life, things that were unexplained and unexplainable that kind of made me more strong in my resolve and my faith as I was moving from a world that was focused on me totally. And that's what addictions do. Even when you don't want to be focused on you, they make you focused on you, to a world that's other focused and everything. And one of the things happened when I was right after I got locked up in county jail. When I went to county jail in 1999, I went there in January 1999. Actually, over the Christmas holiday from December 98. Between Christmas and New Year's, I was living in the dope dealer's house. And for about 16 years of my life, I had wanted to stop using drugs, but I just didn't have the strength and didn't know how. And here I was, right in the middle of between Christmas and New Year's, living at the drug dealer's house. And I gave up. I got down on my knees in the middle of the night one night and I prayed, Lord, please. I believed in you from a long, long time as a child and everything. I never not believed, but I prayed and said, well, you know, I need your help. You know, I want to stop doing this. I want to quit this. I want to be a husband to my wife and a father to my children. Help me. And I got up off my knees that night, like I said, it was the middle of the night in the dope dealer's house, and I went and got high. But you got to be careful what you ask for. Because within 3 weeks of that time, I wound up actually being locked up or detained in Berkeley County Detention Center. And I had so many charges that were brought against me that getting out was nearly impossible. So I started my journey in Berkeley County Detention Center. I went in a heathen. Yeah, I call it that, heathen. But it was there that things started to change. And at Berkeley County, all of the creature comforts were taken from me. My name, my clothes, everything. You know, they didn't have any canteen, so you couldn't buy any like Snicker bars or sodas or nothing like that. You had three hots and a cot. Didn't go outside, wasn't no outside wreck. You stayed inside all the time. If I didn't have so many court cases, I would have just been in there. And all the windows were painted black, so you couldn't even see outside. I remember one time on Easter while I was there, I went to one of the windows where somebody had scratched a little bit of the black off, and I could see the blue sky outside. And it was just so nice. I saw a bird flew by and a plane went by. And I was like, wow, look at that, you know. And I wasn't tripping or nothing either. I had sobered up by then. But you couldn't even have any reading materials, no magazines or nothing like that. The only reading material you could have was religious material. And so I asked my wife, you know, in even visitation. Visitation was through that glass, and the children couldn't even come visit me. So all of the creature comforts were taken away. And my wife brought me this Bible, because after a while, I was like, I got to read something. If the only thing I can read is a Bible, I need that Bible. I got to read. I'm going crazy in here. I wound up staying in there for 8 months at Berkeley County Detention Center. Then I got shipped at the end of 8 months to Charleston County Detention Center. Well, Dorchester County Detention Center first, then back to Charleston County Detention Center. And didn't even go to court over at Dorchester. That's a whole nother story. Then went back to Berkeley County and then to Charleston County Detention Center. And so this was now, I got locked up near the end of January, and this was September. I'd been in county jail from January, from all of February, all the way up through, up till mid-September. Early September, which I celebrated my birthday. My birthday, September 14th, that year in jail, in county jail. So when I went to see the judge, when they shipped me to Charleston County Detention Center, and I went to see the judge there, this judge gave me another very, very high bond, extremely high. And I was really frustrated. And I had been doing some reading, also some legal reading, okay, because legal reading was authorized. But I realized that constitutionally, it couldn't set me an unreasonable bail. And so I wrote a letter to the judge, and I told the judge, I said, Your Honor, you know, I appreciate, you know, what you've done, but what you've actually done is you've levied an unreasonable bail against me. I've been in Berkeley County Detention Center for the last 8 months. I left there, went to Dorchester, back to Berkeley, and then now I'm at Charleston County Detention Center. I have had no income whatsoever. I didn't have any income really when I came in. And now you're giving me a high bond and saying to post this high bond in order to at least try to get out. And that's unreasonable. What you're doing is, if I could pay the bail, you're actually asking me to victimize my family because I have to ask them for it, which is making them a victim. I guess I must have said something right, because the judge wrote back, I think maybe about a week and a half to 2 weeks later, and she reduced my high bonds, all of the bonds, down to $1,000 total. I contacted my wife, and this was right toward the end of September. I contacted her and told her my bond was reduced, and she bailed me out of jail after all that time for, I think, like $200 or something like that. Now, for me, that was a miracle, first off. It was a total miracle. But not her bailing me out, but her bailing me out. That was a miracle too. Okay. Cause she wasn't exactly happy about me either. That's for sure. And hadn't been for a long time. Like I said, that wasn't the man that she wanted to spend her life with, but she came and she got me, and I came home, and, I got home, I think like the last day or so of September. And a few days later, on October 4th, we started this cycle that I just went through, that you all have gone through with me, but I didn't have any grandchildren then. It was just son and daughter, wife, and myself. So when I got home, 4 days later was our daughter's birthday. And I had a chance to celebrate her birthday. I didn't get a chance to celebrate my birthday with the family on September 14th. But I did get a chance to celebrate her birthday. 11 days later, October 15th, was my wife's birthday and our anniversary. I got a chance to celebrate that. The best time of my year, part of my year. Not long after that, a few weeks after that, and coming up, because you're going to see another set of birthday wishes in my household, okay, is our son's birthday, November the 10th. and I was home for his birthday. I mean, the best part of my year, I was blessed to not be locked up and away from my family after this change had begun in me, appreciative of things around me more than I had been in over 30 years. And I was allowed to come home and spend my time with my family during the best part of my year. Was it a miracle? I don't know. But when I look at what happened immediately after that, my son's birthday was on the 10th, is on the 10th of November. And the day following his birthday is when I had to return to court. My first court date after being released from the detention center after bonding out. Now, I figured because I didn't really have an extensive criminal record and all of that, and my crimes were all nonviolent, okay, although felonies, that I was going to at least come out with, you know, house arrest, maybe electronic monitoring or something like that. And we went to court the day after after my son's birthday, our son's birthday, and the judge literally threw the book at me. He gave me 10 years suspended to 5 years. I was like, wow. We went to court. And my most of the time, my Bible was like stuck to my hand. But I was so confident that I was going back home, I left my Bible in my car, in my wife's car. And I went before that judge. And that judge said, nope, I'm not getting ready to allow you to do anything. We are locking you up. You are going straight from here to Kirkland to R&E to begin a 5-year prison sentence. I was like, wow. Wife looked at me and said, can he do that? I was like, shoot, I don't know, but I don't think I better try to run because these folks standing behind me ready to cart me off. And that started my prison term. But where was the miracle in all of this? The miracle was that for those 8 months, over 8 months that I was in the detention centers, literally with no way to get home, no money for bond or anything like that. I don't know what happened to the bonds and the other court cases, but all of a sudden, a bond was attainable. A couple of $100. I came home and was able to celebrate in person my daughter's birthday, my wife's birthday, our anniversary, and my son's birthday, just to turn around and go to prison. For me, looking in retrospect, that was a miracle. God gave me the best days of my year, restored those to me, and then said, okay, I'm not finished cleaning you up, and I need you to go back inside of the prison system while I finish working on you, and while you're in the prison system, you are going to be working on some other things for me. So as I just wanted to share that tonight to those who just don't know the intro. I have a million stories, and I've been talking about this book. I need to get this book written, but it'll probably be boring though. But I have a million of these stories. So it's been such an amazing trip. I don't even know how I'm in the position I'm in. I don't know why that lady loved me. I don't know. There was a song called Butterfly Kisses by this guy named Bob Carlyle. And the tagline in it said, the chorus said, out of all that I've done wrong, I must have done something right to deserve your love in the morning and butterfly kisses at night. That's my song to my baby girl. But as I look at the blessings that I've got now, that I've been received now, I mean, to come out of the prison system, 30 years of alcohol and drug addiction, almost ruining my marriage and my family, been shot at, all of these things, to go from the prison to the pulpit to running for Congress and a mayor's office and all of these things, and not because I was seeking any kind of notoriety, standing with those who have lost loved ones to gun violence for so long and advocating inside of school boards for quality public education so all of our children could get educated, pushing for affordable health care, universal health care and accessible housing, advocating for the homeless, trying to end domestic violence. All of those things are the outcropping of the love that I received from God, who didn't throw me away, who didn't look on me as if, well, he'll never be anything. He knew the end from the beginning. He knew that that point would come in my life. And, you know, forgive me if I'm being preachy, but this is just me talking about me. I'm not saying that this is supposed to be you. But it's what an amazing, amazing journey it's been. And to sit here tonight with my wife and to have her to continue to reaffirm our love and commitment, to be able to just share her life and our son's life. My son at one point told me he hated me. Won't he do it? Wouldn't let me perform the wedding, his wedding ceremony. I thought it was because he was still having bad feelings. But after telling me he hated me years before, he said, I can't let you perform the wedding ceremony because you need to stand in the place that you really deserve. And that's as my best man, because you are my best man. You're my best friend. And folks, that broke me up. And it does to this day. And if I ever thought about returning to the life that I used to live, I would never do it, because the things that God has blessed me with today are just so wonderful. They're so good. They're so great. And you all, every last one of you on here, are part of that blessing. Every one of you. And that's why I fight so hard to make it right for each and every one of you. It's not easy being a truth teller. People come at you. They don't like you. I've been cussed out, threatened, everything in the world that you could think about. But I decided that I was not going to go back to that other person, because when I see you all, your faces, your advocacy, when you share your pain and I'm able to partner with you in that pain to help you through, those are much more important than me allowing myself to be drugged back into the pits of destruction that I was in before. And then still to get up and see that lady that started the broadcast with me. And sometimes I make her smile. It's a good thing. It's a good thing. And to see you all give me that same smile. You give me that same hope. You make me believe that in spite of what we see going on, in spite of the White House and a Congress that's crazy, and a state house that's crazy, and a state that's tripping, and the pandemic, and all these other, in spite of all of that, you all help me to know that there is a better way, and a better day is coming. And I just want to thank each and every one of you all for being the amazing people that you are. So whenever you hear me tell you that I love you, I want you to know that I truly do. I truly do. And there's absolutely nothing that you can do about that. Yep. I got some frenemies on here right now. And I guess they'll just have to be mad at me because I won't become enemies with them. Because I love them and there's absolutely nothing they can do about that. Too bad. Get over it. Never drag me into that pit, that's for sure. It's too many reasons to smile in spite of everything. And as we look toward this election, as we look to the short couple of weeks that are left and the possibility of a new America, an America where hopes and dreams are become reality, an America where people will fight against racism instead of turning their heads to it or not addressing it, an America where Black lives will finally matter, an America where all children will have an equal chance at the American dream because the educational system is good for everyone. An America where people aren't targeted for incarceration, but instead are lifted above the prison system and back into society. An America where we have a shining example of humanity as our leader, who is kind, who is compassionate. And in the midst of that kindness and compassion, is still able to do justice and love mercy and walk humbly before our God. I could probably ramble on for a while, but I'm going to call this and bring this to an end, okay? But before I do, I want to make sure everybody's aware of what's happening as far as announcements. I know. Got to thank my wife for sure for stopping on in. She just, man, I don't know if y'all see it, but every time I think about her, I smile. And there's some of you all. So if I ever tag you and say that you made my heart smile, know that this picture that you got right now, yep, that's exactly what I'm doing. Okay, announcements. Okay, I'm going to have brief COVID updates during my Facebook Lives. I'll probably be doing Facebook Lives maybe 4 out of 5 days this week, okay? As we're getting closer to the election, I got to bring it. Got to bring it, okay? So we're going to be doing them most days this week and probably next week too. But the Facebook Lives this week are going to be specific, dealing with the school board issue. And after all of that wonderful conversation we've just had, I don't want to be the Debbie Downer or anything like that, but or the David Downer or whatever you want to call him. But I'm going to be talking about the Coalition for Kids this week and who they support and who's supporting them. Okay, it's time to get down and dirty on this thing. It's time to let the truth come out. You know, and you all, please forgive me because I've been sharing some. Interviews and Facebook Lives that others, other community leaders and activists have been doing. And there's a little bit of profanity in some of them. But I'm going to have to ask everybody to please step away from the judgment on this, at least until after the election, okay? Because there are some very important messages that I need to be putting forth right now. And I don't have the ability to censor anyone. I never try to censor anyone, but or to delete the cuss words out or anything like that. So I'm just putting them out there. I need you to go for the message, okay? Not the way the message is delivered, but the message. It's going to be information in these with these broadcasters. I'm gonna something things from Tamika Gadsden and the Charleston Activist Network. I posted an interview today with Kristen Graziano that she did. I got another one with Ben Polk. I got some things from her on Coalition for Kids. I got that's going to be tomorrow. Please check my page for Mika Gadsden's Facebook Live on the Coalition for Kids. It don't get no better than this one, okay? But it's going with some cussing in there, though, so I'm just letting y'all know some cussing. So don't be coming back, pastor. No, okay, get over it, okay? We need to set this thing out and set the record straight, okay? But not only her, I'll have some Facebook Lives that AJ Davis have done, Anjanae Davis have done in the past, dealing with the same thing. And I'll be talking about, you know, the executive director of Coalition for Kids, Josh Bell. I'll be talking about former Mayor Joe Rowley. I'll be talking about billionaire Ben Navarro and Anita Zucker, and others who are deeply involved in this privatization scam that's going to ultimately begin to break or to set our children, our poor children, black children and brown children and Native American children up for a life of poverty and incarceration. Not going to let it happen, okay? And as we're moving into this election, and we have a school board race where we have five candidates, okay? Several of them are on here right now. Erica Coakley's on here right now for School Board District 10. We have Regina Duggins on here for the Peninsula right now. And I don't know whether Kristen French and Kevin Hollinshed, I don't know whether the two of them are on here also. And also Francis Baylott. Those are my folks, okay? Those, if you see anybody else talking about them other folks, them ain't my folks. Okay, for sure. Especially the five I'm going to talk about with this Coalition for Kids. All right. All five of them. All right. So that's going to be the schedule for this week, what we're going to talk about this week and next week. I just wanted to give you all a little alert. As far as events, tomorrow. Okay. Tomorrow. I don't think I've been on too long, have I? Okay. I'm getting on about an hour. Tomorrow. If anybody's available at 2 o'clock in the afternoon tomorrow, please meet myself, Reverend Nelson B. Rivers, the third, and some of our other younger activists from United Front, Stand as One, over at Mount Pleasant, the Mount Pleasant office for somebody's state senator, United States Senator Lindsey Graham. He ain't my senator, that's for sure. Senator Graham, he's a piece of work, okay? For sure. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Francis Marion Baylott in the house. That's right. That's right. We need you on that board, sir. That's for sure. We need you on that board. You know, I can deal with those other four coalition members that are there. But we can't give them five more. They can't let them or two more or one more. Four is enough. We need to make sure that we don't get any more Coalition for Kids people on that Charleston County School Board. But Senator Graham, this dude, I don't know if y'all heard it, but this dude in the confirmation hearings for the Supreme Court Justice to replace Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, in the confirmation hearings, this dude says that he believes that segregation in America was the good old days. Segregation in America was the good old days. And he also said recently that the way for black people to get ahead is by making themselves more acceptable to conservative white people, you know, shuffling along, you know, go along to get along, you know, be them good boys, good girls. We would be more accepted in America, not being free-thinking African-Americans, people of respect or whatever, but subservient to the conservative culture. He said these things. He literally said these things over the last, like, week and a half. Guess he wants us all to be. And I mean no disrespect to the other senator, but, you know, if the shoe fit, wear it. Tim Scott, I guess that's the way he wants us to be. I'm not, I ain't that one. Reverend Nelson B. Rivers III is not that one. Our younger groups that's out here fighting for justice, they're not that one. And we're going to let Lindsey Graham know tomorrow. We ain't that one. So if you can, 2 o'clock We assemble at 1:30, okay, at Lindsey Graham's office. Lindsey Graham's office is right off the other side of the Ravenel Bridge on the Mount Pleasant side, 530 Johnny Dodge Boulevard. I'm going to post this up, a flyer up, as soon as I finish this. 530 Johnny Dodge Boulevard. We'll be out on the sidewalk, on the street side of the sidewalk, because you can't necessarily gather in front of his office there, okay? But you please join Reverend Nelson B. Rivers III, myself, and other black clergy, local black clergy, as well as community leaders, activists, and our allies. So all are welcome. All are welcome as we gather in front of Graham's office in Mount Pleasant to let him know that we will not stand still and let him walk us back to the Jim Crow. We will not do it. That day is over. And as long as he thinks like that, his time is up. Let's just make this perfectly clear. Even if he continues to think like that, his time is up. Jamie Harrison for U.S. Senate. Make sure you get out and vote, and make sure other people get out there to vote. Jamie Harrison. Pull that straight blue ticket, straight Democratic ticket. Don't waste no time. And after you vote straight Democratic for all the Democrats down that ticket, when you get to the school board race, vote the candidates of your choice. Of your choice. My choices are Erica Coakley, Francis Baylott, Kevin Hollinshed, Kristen French, and Regina Duggins. Those are my choices. All right. I'm not going to tell you who to vote for, though. That's for sure. So that's tomorrow, 2:00, Lindsey Graham's office. I'm going to have this stuff posted up on my pages, okay, also. Next Saturday, in the Waylon Heart team, Shamiki Gray and her team over in the Waylon, okay? They've got two things going on next Saturday, all right? And these are in the afternoon. You have both of them are from 5:00 until 7:00 p.m. Both of them are going to be at the Waylon Playground over on Olympia Street, right inside of the Waylon, okay? But the first event is the Youth Entrepreneurs Day. And we're going to have realtors and nurses and jewelers and photographers and chefs and craftsmen and artisans all there with their various tables talking to the youth of the community and adults in the community about entrepreneurship, entrepreneurial endeavors, sowing back into the community, and ultimately teaching how we as a community rise economically by investing more in our own communities. You see, we're at a different place now. We're at a different place now than we have ever been. We're at a place where we're all going to rise and we're going to come up together. The educational process, we're not waiting on anybody to come and educate our communities. We are doing them ourselves, and the Waylon Art team is one of those teams that's out here doing it. Gen Z is also out here doing it. Gen Z is made up of 18 to 24 year olds. That's right. That's right. Activists who are ready to turn this community around. And they got the energy actually to hit the streets and talk a little mess too. For sure. They ain't no joke. We also have that afternoon, and I'm going to talk about what's going to happen that morning as I close, okay? That afternoon in the Waylon also will be the Youth Halloween Carnival. The Youth Halloween Carnival from 5:00 until 7:00, and that's at the playground also. Best costume contest with a cash prize now in three different age group categories, okay? So get the kids, get the costumes off. You know, on Halloween, I take my mask off. You know, that's the one day a year I get to take my mask off, okay? But that day, you know, that day for both events, there's going to be food and games and more. So please, these things are going to be on my page. Support the Waylon Heart team. Now, that morning, okay, and we're still working on the details on it. It should be happening, but this might be dropping this at the last minute. But we're going to need as many people to come out as possible that morning for the March of Generations. March of Generations. This is a unity march that's been put together by United Front, Stand as One, Reverend Nelson B. Rivers III, myself, and others, trying to bring to light the necessity of us coming together, okay? This march will start probably at Martin Park down in the city, down on the east side. And we're going to march near the cigar factory because of the historic nature of what happened at the cigar factory, and end at Mall Park, where we'll have a rally talking about unity, talking about economic development, talking about policing and police reform, talking about Black Lives Matter, talking about all the things that matter to the people that definitely live in that community, but folks, no matter where they are. And I want everybody to understand, Black Lives Matter is not a Black Lives Only problem. Come on, somebody. That's for sure. And that's why I embrace white allies. For sure. So that's that morning. We start gathering, I do believe, at 9 o'clock, 9:30. I'll put the flyer up, okay? I'll put the flyer up, and that way everybody can make sure that if they can be there, set your date, save the date right now, okay? Save the date so you can possibly, Roy, it's a me problem. Save the date, please, so that you can come on out, you know, and it's going to be a safe walk. We don't, you know, none of us do. We don't deal in that foolishness, that's for sure. And let me just put it out right now. If anybody got it in your mind that you want to have that foolishness, you ain't got to worry about the police shutting you down. We're going to shut you down. That's what we do. We police our own marches. We don't let no foolishness come in. Because when we put our name on it and our stamp on it, we're going to make sure that the end of it ain't going to be no foolishness, period. You know. So we call everybody within our own crowd to be our own police force. Not forcibly, but smartly. To shut any kind of foolishness down. So I just want to put that out there and let everybody know. That's for sure. We don't do that. Yeah. So aside from that, we got a couple of winter clothing drives going on. I just want to put it out there so everybody knows about them. Stand is one, South Carolina. Stand is one SC has their winter clothing drive. Started on October 13th and ends on November 6th. Donations are needed of new and gently used coats, gloves, leggings, closed-toe shoes, boots, winter hats, new socks, okay? Please, if you're in any kind of way or position to donate to Stand as One on in their winter drive, either clothing, financial donations, I'm going to put the flyer up. That way you can get in touch with them. This is Justin Crucifix Hunt and Leilani and their whole group. And they're just an amazing group of folks. You see, the young activists is out here. They're not trying to tear up nothing and carrying on like they've been painted as. No, they're trying to build community. Community, trying to harbor or foster the unity necessary in order for all of us to move together forward. Okay? Not tearing up stuff and carrying on. So don't let nobody tell you that. Okay? They lying. And also, that Stand is One's winter clothing drive, and also Uplift Charleston. Aaron Comstock and Uplift Charleston, their coat and blanket drive. It started on the 16th, and it's continuing all the way until November 20th, okay? And Aaron and Uplift Charleston are looking for coats, blankets, sleeping bags, socks, gloves, hats, scarves, and pillows. And I'll post that information on the flyer on my pages also. Just remember, folks, we have a homeless population. I don't care who tries to avoid the thought of it or tries to underplay the fact of it. We have a homeless problem. I work along with the Working Women's Welfare Group with Pastor Alfreda Dees Potts and her organization who are trying to innovatively and having researched best practices in other cities to get our legislators to move on some of our city governments to allot a hotel that can be converted into housing for homeless. What better way to do it? And other cities are doing this. Other cities are doing this. And here we are. We want to just run out and pass out a blanket when it's cold outside instead of giving people real, substantive, tangible help. It's time to change that dynamic and make sure. And that's why this election is so important. And that's why there's so many amazing people out here. So those are some of the things that's happening. We're going to have more coming on. I'm going to call an end to this evening. I do believe I just went a little bit longer than I had expected. But the first part of this was what this was all about. The announcements, yes, but the first part. Talking about how much I love and appreciate you all. Talking about how much, from my wife's perspective, how much she loves and appreciates you all. You all are just amazing. Don't discount yourselves. Don't let anybody try to make you think like you're less than you're the best. You're the best. And I'm not just saying that just to be saying it. I'm saying it because I know it, each and every one of you. And I understand that everybody can't be at everything. So don't try. It's okay. It's all right. I just want everybody, all of you, love yourselves. Please. Love yourselves. Take time for self-care. Jason, Justin, Maddie, Brooke, take time for self-care too. Gareth, self-care, okay? Because you're going to need that rejuvenation, that resurgence of energy, because this battle is long and it's a hard fight. Erica, take care of yourself. And I see what you're doing on this school board race. And don't let the haters bring you down, because haters gonna hate. But everybody on here, y'all, just keep on grinding. Change is coming. It's not that far off. Keep imagining a world where people are treated right. A world where there are more examples of people who tell the truth and show love than those who lie and promote hate. A world where our children can believe in a future, all of them, all of them. A world where the relics of torture and hate and brutality of the past become the empty spaces of the future that we can fill with love and joy and peace and understanding. And the biggest place where we have to fill up for many of us is right inside of our hearts. Just as my wife said, if each one of us starts with us and we fix ourselves, we can truly change the world. Y'all take care. I love you all so very much. Give my wife a shout out every now and then and just thank her for lending me to the world. And I'm so happy to have each and every one of you all in my life. And if the frenemies hung on to the end, or if they didn't, tonight, before you all go to bed, please make sure that you hug your little ones, hug your spouse, baby mama, baby daddy, boyfriend, girlfriend, your puppy, kitty cat, pet snake. Hug, just tell somebody you love them. And begin to make it a habit telling people that you love them, even those who are not lovable. Give it a try. I got a couple of people I got to reach out to. Just full transparency. I know it ain't easy, but sometimes you just got to do it. You got to press through. And trust me, if you try it, on the other side of pressing through, on the other side of telling somebody who is not lovable that you love them, oh, there's a blessing on that other side, and you'll sleep good at night. Listen, y'all take care. I love each and every one of you all, and no matter what you say, do, or think, I love you, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it. Y'all take care. God bless. Peace.